blessed assurance. Jesus is mine. He's been my fourth man in the fire, time after time. Born of His Spirit, washed in His blood. And what He did for me on Calvary is more than enough. Oh, I trust in God, my Savior, the one who will never fail. He will never fail.
Amen. Welcome. Welcome. All right, guys. We just got in, actually. Had a little bit of a late start tonight, but it's good to have you on. We're going to finish another book tonight. So, Ecclesiastes. Wow. Mark is coming. Give me 1 second. I want to make sure everyone's good. Hey, Crypto. It's good to see you, brother. Bellinger, Teresa. It's good to see everybody. Oh. There he is. Hey, bro, I just sent Peter the link. How are you, Schmores?
Good. What's going on?
My wife, she had to work tonight, and she didn't take any food. And so the girls and I surprised her. We got her some food and something cool to drink, and we surprised her at work, so she was happy.
Well, that's nice. They don't have a cafe.
No. Because she worked graveyard.
Oh, so it closes down?
Yeah. Yeah, well, they don't have anything. Sucks. I know. Yeah. Yeah. Peter, you want to give him a quick call?
Did you see what I sent you?
Hold on, let me check. We're going to finish the Ecclesiastes tonight, man. I'm excited.
That's the fact, Jack.
Isn't that awesome?
Peter back?
He is back, yeah.
Oh, he must be on. He just hung up on me.
Hold on.
When it rings twice and it hangs up, he's there. So we got 9, 10, 11, 12.
Yeah, how's the weather over there?
Right now?
Yeah.
Probably 90-something. Let's see. About half an hour ago, it was 97. Whoa, it's getting cold.
What is that, 95? You're funny.
I get a jacket.
You are funny, Schmores. All right, let's see. Ecclesiastes 9. Here it is. I got it.
You know what the Garden Fellowship where I go, they're doing their Bible study. They're doing the they're in Genesis. It's gonna take 7 years to do the whole thing that we're doing in 1 year.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
That's crazy.
I'll send you one thing of Jason doing. We just today was talking about Joseph.
That's nuts. Hey, Bellinger said it's 62 degrees where he's at.
I don't even know how to spell 62.
That's crazy.
Wow. See, it's not going to change here. It'll be the low. I mean, the coldest it got, I think it was last week, it got to 81 in the morning. But it heats up very fast. It's going to be 90 to 110 until October. That's just the way it is down here. But it's been cooler. Like today was 107. It's hot, but it's not as hot as it's been. Crypto Rob is on.
Yeah. Well, let's go ahead and get the show on the road. Peter did call me earlier. He made it back home safely. So thanks for your prayers, guys.
Oh, so they are home.
Oh yeah, he made it back early today.
Early?
Like early? Yeah, yeah. Maybe noontime or something like that.
Well, that's not that bad. That means they left early.
Okay, so what's going on here?
There's no headers on any of these.
I do have a commentary here on Ecclesiastes 9. It says, by no outward thing can man know whom God loveth or hateth. No man knoweth his end. Wisdom excelleth strength. Man, this is... And all along, I wish I could show you guys a picture of this. All along the side.
Notes?
Of Ecclesiastes chapter 9. The entire page almost is just notes.
Wow.
Yeah, and they're random notes, just random.
So they're heavy duty. They're big verses.
Yeah.
Okay, well, let's go. He'll join in like he does.
All right, let's go ahead and pray. 1 second. All right, S'mores. All right, guys, let's go ahead and pray. All right, thank you everyone for being on, and pray that you're doing well and had a great Sunday. And we are ready to go into Ecclesiastes. We'll be finishing tonight, Lord willing, and I'm really excited about that. And then tomorrow we'll start our Song of Solomon series, which will be very, very interesting love story. I'm kind of curious to what you guys will think about that. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this beautiful day, this day that is set aside for worship, Lord. And I just thank you, Lord, for those preachers who have just maintained their testimony, Lord, and proclaimed the gospel week after week after week, Lord. And we just pray for our churches here in America. Pray also for our brothers and sisters in Christ who are being persecuted in different parts of the world. I know in certain parts of India there's some unrest right now. I was told towards the northern part of India, Christians are being persecuted. And pray for them, Lord, that you would be with them during that time and give them victory, Lord. I pray that your gospel would be proclaimed no matter what. Thank you for this time that we can read your word together, Lord, that we finish another book tonight. Give us clarity of thought. May we focus on what it is that you have for us tonight. I pray for each person who's on, Lord, and give us wisdom, we pray, Lord. We pray for hurting hearts tonight, and we just thank you, God, that you're the God of all comfort. We love you, and we praise you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, so let's load her up.
Nine. Lock and loaded.
Very beautiful. Okay.
Love both.
Okay, so let me go ahead and get... All right, guys, let's run. So Ecclesiastes 9, how many verses is it?
Eight. Was it 18?
18. Okay. Okay. Yeah. Not long. Not terribly long. All right. Let's run. How's my audio?
Good.
All right. So, Bride, we just prayed. We just prayed, and we're going to jump right into Ecclesiastes 9, Bride.
So, yeah, I was walking around in the neighborhood, catching up on some exercise, trying to get rid of my great big fat gut.
Well, you know, everyone's excited to have you back. So, and you look like you got a pretty nice tan too. It looks like you have a nice tan.
Everyone?
Yeah. Look like you got a really nice tan, Peter.
Looks like the wind came out of the south.
Yeah. Oh, man. All right. So, Peter, I don't know about you. I'm excited. We're going to finish another book tonight. So, Ecclesiastes chapter 9.
Teresa, Dorothy wanted to thank you for wishing her a happy birthday yesterday. Yeah. Okay, Ecclesiastes chapter 9. Got it.
All right. Awesome, guys. I'm going to just go ahead and start. Peter, you got your King James open, and Mark, you got your ESV.
I got both.
Okay, guys. I'll go ahead and get started here.
Okay.
All right. Verses are on the screen. All right, perfect. I'll be reading out of my facsimile. Okay, here it is. Oh, what did I do? Sorry, my mouse is acting weird. There it is. Okay, so let's begin. Solomon continues here in chapter 9. I have surely given mine heart to all this, and to declare all this, that the just and the wise and their works are in the hand of God, and no man knoweth either love or hatred of all that is before him. All things come alike to all, and the same condition is to the just and to the wicked, to the good and to the pure, and to the polluted, and to him that sacrificeth, and to him that sacrificeth not. As is the good, so is the sinner. He that sweareth, as he that feareth an oath. Verse 3. This is evil among all that is done under the sun, that there is one condition to all, and also the heart of the sons of men is full of evil, and madness is in their hearts while they live, and after that, they go to the dead. Man, this is heavy. Okay. Okay, verse 4. Let's just continue. Verse 4. He says, surely, whosoever is joined to all the living, there is hope. For it is better to be a living dog than to be a dead lion. That is heavy. It's better to be a living dog than to be a dead lion. There's a typo there on the screen. I don't know if you guys see it. It says, for it is better to a living dog than to a dead lion. And obviously, that should say, it is better to be a living dog than to be a dead lion. I think the King James says that. So, okay, verse 5, we'll continue. For the living know that they shall die, but the dead know nothing at all, neither have they any more a reward, for their remembrance is forgotten. Do not take that literal, okay, guys? This is not true, okay? The dead do not know nothing, okay? There's a place called hell, and they will know, and they'll be able to remember. And we'll talk more about that, but yeah, hell is a real place. If heaven is real, so is hell. So, but I think he's talking here in maybe, I don't know, I don't want to say he's not being, maybe cynical. He's being a little bit cynical. He says, for the living know that they're going to die, but the dead know nothing at all. Neither have they any more a reward, for their remembrance is forgotten. Verse 6, he says, also their love and their hatred, also their love and their hatred and their envy is now perished, and they have no more portion forever in all that is done under the sun. Verse 7, Go, eat thy bread with joy and drink thy wine with a cheerful heart, for God now accepteth thy works. At all times let thy garments be white, and let not oil be lacking upon thine head. Rejoice with the wife whom thou hast loved all the days of the lot. Now hold on, isn't that weird for him to say that? Didn't he have 700 wives? Hold on, let's read this again. He says, rejoice with the wife whom thou hast loved all the days of the life of thy vanity, which God hath given thee under the sun, all the days of thy vanity, for this is thy portion in thy life and in the travail wherein thou laborest under the sun. But that's a very kind of a choppy verse there. You guys got some, Mark, can you read it in verse 9 maybe? Hold on, let me unmute you. What do you got in verse 9? Because it kind of read a little choppy to me.
Choppy, okay. Enjoy life with the wife whom you love, all the days of your vain life that he has given you under the sun, because that is your portion in life and in your toil at which you toil under the sun.
What is he saying?
Enjoy your life with the wife. Yeah, but which one?
I mean, verse 8 says, at all times let thy garments be white and let not oil be lacking. Well, that's very expensive. The oil was very pricey. You know, it was pricey. And he says, hey, just splurge. You know, have white clothes all the time. Have new clothes all the time. Clean clothes. Splurge with oil. Love your wife. Spend time with her. But what is he saying? It's like it's all, not, it doesn't matter. Is that what he's saying?
Because that is your portion in life.
You're going to die anyway, so go ahead and max out your credit cards. Is that what he's saying? I mean, Peter, yeah. Peter, help us. Peter, help us out, man. What's going on here? Verse 9.
All days of the vanity, for that is the portion of this life, and in thy
any
labor,
help? Which is any help, guys, on that one?
Under the sun. You know, the King James is almost the same.
So every day that God gives you, every day that God gives you, live it, make it count.
Is that what he's saying though? Because it almost sounds like he's saying, go ahead and get the filet mignon. You know, forget the chicken nuggets. Go for the filet mignon. You know, get the oil. Wear the white clothes. Spend time with your girl. I mean, I don't know. It almost sounds like he's just telling us to let loose.
No, you know what? Actually, in verse 10, it really delineates in verse 10. In verse 10, whatsoever thy hand findeth to do it with thy might. For there is no word, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. So do it, handle it. Do it with thy might.
Do it right.
Do it with thy might. Every day that God gives you, make it count. Do it with thy might.
No, that verse I get. I like that verse.
They all go together. Live life. Live life.
Okay. So let me just backtrack here. Just for a second. I'll just read it quick. Verse 7, it says, go eat thy bread with joy and drink thy wine with a cheerful heart, for God now accepteth thy works. At all times let thy garments be white, and let not oil be lacking upon thine hand. Rejoice with the wife whom thou hast loved all the days of the life of thy vanity. That word vanity is basically, what is he saying? It's pointless. Vanity. All this stuff is pointless. Vanity. It's all vain. It's all, we're going to die anyhow. Nothing matters. I mean, that's kind of what vanity means. Vanity of vanities. He says, rejoice with the wife whom thou hast loved all the days of the life of thy vanity, which God hath given thee under the sun all the days of thy vanity, for this is thy portion in the life and in the travail wherein thou laborest under the sun. Verse 10, all that thine hand shall find to do, do it with all thy power, for there is neither work nor invention nor knowledge nor wisdom in the grave whither thou goest. So it's, he's
vanity,
saying, hey,
Omar, it's vanity, so make the most of it. Make the most of it.
So he's saying in verse 10, at the end of verse 10, he said, in the grave, you're not going to be able to do anything.
Right.
Right?
So here, handle it. Do it with thy might.
So when you and I were in Vegas, and we were going to take the girls out for a nice dinner, right? You said, let's go to the little Chinese buffet house, or let's go to the, you know, the other $9 buffet, right?
Yeah.
And I said, Peter, I said, we never do this. I said, let's just go ahead and go all out. And we went to the $75 a plate buffet. Now, I know that was splurging. I understand that. But I think it's applicable here to what Solomon's kind of saying. He's saying, just do it. Like Nike, just do it. Because you won't be able to do it in the grave.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm getting out of this. But even then, I feel that he's saying, even if you did all that stuff, it doesn't matter. I don't see a man that's happy. I really don't.
No, he's not happy when he's doing this.
Yeah, I don't see him as happy. It's just, I don't know. Well, let's keep reading. So, but I do like that verse, Peter, verse 10. I've always, especially to my young people, like when I'm ministering to them or, you know, trying to counsel them, I say, hey, look, whatever God puts you in your hand, do it with all your might. Because I use that verse there because I think it is a beautiful picture of, hey, you know what? If we are going to do it, go all in. Don't just go halfway.
Yeah.
Okay, verse 11. Hold on, let me get to that.
You know, again, this is. It sounds like he's at the end of his line. You know,
right.
That's what it sounds like. I mean, it's been sounding like that since we started this.
Since we started Ecclesiastes,
yeah,
right?
It's like, you know, oh well, I'll write this stuff. I'll show you guys.
You know? Let me see verse 11.
You think this is a bowl of cherries? I mean, come on.
Right? He says here, I returned and I saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor yet bread to the wise, nor also riches to men of understanding, neither yet favor to men of knowledge, but time and chance cometh to them all. He's saying, look, it's not how fast you are, not how strong you are, not how smart you are, not how wise you are. It's all just up to God, really. Your lot is up to God. He says, time and chance cometh to them all. Verse 12 says, For neither doth man know his time, but as the fishes, which are taken in an evil net, and as the birds that are caught in the snare, so are the children of men snared in the evil time when it falleth upon. So he's saying, hey, look, just like those fish that you caught today when you went out fishing, how did they know which one was going to get caught and which one was going to go free? They didn't. It just happened.
Time and chance.
Yeah. So he's saying, so why are some people rich and some people in despair? It's time and chance, right? So it's pretty profound what he's saying. I mean, wow, Peter, wow.
Yeah.
Oh man, this is heavy. Okay, verse 13. Wow. Okay. Verse 13. He says, I have also seen that wisdom under the sun. I have also seen this wisdom under the sun, and it is great unto me. A little city and few men in it, and a great king came against it, and compassed it about, and builded forts against it. And there was found therein a poor and wise man, and he delivered the city by his wisdom. But none remembered this poor man. Then said I, better is wisdom than strength. Yet the wisdom of the poor is despised, and his words are not heard. The words of the wise are more heard in quietness than the cry of him that ruleth among fools. Let me read that again, verse 17.
Yeah, that's good.
That's great. That's amazing. The words of the wise are more heard in quietness than the cry of him that ruleth among fools.
Yeah, fools, they don't listen to anything.
Wow. Better is wisdom than weapons of war, but one sinner destroyeth much good. Oh man, guys.
Omar, that's where that expression comes from. A bad apple will spoil the whole bunch.
What do you guys, yeah. What did you guys get about that wise man that saved the city from the wicked king, but no one even batted an eye? what we just read there about. It says that the city 14? Was taken. It was a small city.
14?
Yeah, verse 14. And then there was a wise man, a poor and a wise man, verse 15 says, and he saved the city. He delivered the city. We don't know how. Well, it says by his wisdom. Maybe he came up with some amazing way to, you know, defeat this wicked king who was trying to destroy the city, or, you know, besiege the city. But he delivered them. He said, but nobody even
remembered the poor man.
Paid attention to him.
Yeah.
Wow. Man. So much, guys. I know we're just kind of cruising through this, but there's so much to chew on in all this. And every chapter in Ecclesiastes has just been very meaty. Very meaty. Okay, that was chapter 9. Chapter 10 is, let me see, what is this chapter 10 about? It says, the difference of foolishness and wisdom. A slanderer is like a serpent that cannot be charmed, of foolish kings and drunken princes, and of good kings and princes. So these are just some of the bullet points that are in this chapter. All right, let's continue, guys. I'll just keep reading here, Ecclesiastes 10. I never understood this one about the dead flies, but let's see if we can figure it out. Okay, verse 1. Dead flies cause to stink and putrefy the ointment of the apothecary, so doth a little folly him that is in estimation for wisdom and for glory. Well, I don't know. I don't want to fly in my soup or my ointment or anywhere near anything that I have. Flies are pretty gross, but it's, I'm not sure exactly what that verse means, but anyhow.
Omar, it's pretty simple. Dead flies cause ointment of the apothecary to smell bad. And similar to that, a little folly of him that is in reputation for wisdom and honor. So, like, folly, a little folly just destroys one's character.
Right, right. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, I can think of somebody right now that you and I know. Yeah, a little folly can destroy someone's character. Actually, I can think of a couple people. I won't mention, but we're not talking about you, Mark. All right, hold on. Goodbye. Verse 2. Thank you, Peter, for clarifying that, by the way. Verse 2. The heart of a wise man is at his right hand, but the heart of a fool is at his left hand. Ah.
Yeah, I don't understand that. That's,
you want to be right.
Yeah, I don't. There's some kind of, like, tradition or something. It's probably would merit a little bit of studying on that.
You want to hear something interesting? In Spanish, there's something really interesting here, and I'll try to put it in simple terms. But in Spanish, the way to say right-handed is, I'll give you guys a little Spanish lesson.
Rachel?
is diestra.
Yes.
Diestra. Yes. So D-I-E-S-T-R-A. So diestra. So that's how you say it, right hand. Now, and that means to be right, the right-handed. That's diestra. It almost like straight, derecho.
Derecho?
Yeah, kind of, but the proper way is diestra. Now, the way to say left-handed, check this out.
Derecha.
Siniestro. Siniestro. Kind of sounds like sinister, right? That's where the word sinister comes from, actually. Siniestro. That's how you say left-handed.
Siniestro.
Siniestro, yeah, which is, by the way, the same root of the word sinister. So right hand is the one that's, you know, strength and to be correct and just. The left hand is malicious and evil. That's kind of a very interesting. Anyhow, siniestro and diestro. But I don't know what this means here. It could be in verse 10. The heart of the wise man is at his right hand, but the heart of the fool is which hand? Which hand? The left. Could be something there, guys. I don't know. Could be something there. We can always leave that for further study. But anyhow, verse 3.
Omar, it says, I did a quick little search. It says, since the right hand was regarded as the sign of strength, skill, and favor, the wise man's heart is known and a strength to him. So that,
okay.
Since the right hand was regarded as the sign of strength, skill, and favor.
Yeah, yep. Makes sense. Makes absolute sense. And so the left hand would be the opposite, right?
Yeah.
Verse 3. It says, and also when the fool goeth by the way, his heart faileth, and he telleth unto all that he is a fool. If the spirit of him that ruleth rise up against thee, leave not thy place, for gentleness pacifieth great sins. Verse 5. There's an evil that I have seen under the sun, as an error that proceedeth from the face of him that ruleth. Folly is set in great excellency, and the rich set in the low place. And the rich set in the low place. Verse 7. I have seen servants on horses and princes walking as servants on the ground. He that diggeth a pit shall fall into it, and he that breaketh a hedge, a serpent shall bite him. He that removeth stone shall hurt himself thereby, and he that cutteth wood shall be in danger thereby. Verse 10. If the iron be blunt, and one hath not wet the edge, he must then put to more strength, but the excellency to direct a thing is wisdom. That is deep. If the iron be blunt, that means not very sharp, and one hath not wet the edge, he must then put to more strength. That means you got to work harder because it's not cutting as well as it should. But the excellency to direct a thing is wisdom. So the smart person says, hey, instead of working so hard and swinging so heavily, I'm just going to go ahead and sharpen my axe. Right? Is that what that pretty much...
the wisdom helps one to succeed.
Yeah, wow.
And the KJV says, but wisdom is profitable to direct. So you know exactly where to strike, where it's important to strike. But wisdom is profitable to direct.
Nice. So use your brain, not your muscle. Is that what you're saying?
Correct.
Yeah, well, you need both, but your brain will give you more leverage.
Nice. Well, let's think about that tomorrow morning as we start our week, Peter.
Yeah.
Actually, our Mondays start on Sunday night, so. Okay, verse 11. If the serpent bite when he is not charmed, no better is a babbler. It almost sounds like a proverb. If the serpent bite when he is not charmed, no better is a babbler. The words of the mouth of a wise man have grace, but the lips of a fool devour himself. Sounds like Proverbs, guys. Verse 13. The beginning of the words of his mouth is foolishness, and the latter end of his mouth is wicked madness. For the fool multiplieth words, saying, man knoweth not what shall be, and who can tell him what shall be after him? verse 15. The labor of the foolish doth weary him, for he knoweth not to go into the city. Did I read that right? The labor of the foolish man doth weary him, for he knoweth not to go into the city. What does that mean in verse 15? The labor of the foolish wearies him, for he knoweth not to go into the city. Any ideas?
Toil of a fool wearies him. He does not know the way to the city. The fool doesn't know where he's going.
The labor of the foolish doth weary him. Okay, so he gets tired. You're right. For he knoweth not to go into the city. Not sure. There's not much meat. There's not much context there for us to take anything from that. Go into the city. I'm not sure what that means. Let's go to verse 16 and see if we have more clarity on this. Woe to thee, O land, when thy king is a child and thy princes eat in the morning. Blessed art thou, O land, when thy king is the son of nobles and thy princes eat in time for strength and not for drunkenness. Verse 17, blessed art thou, O land, when the king is the son of nobles and thy princes eat in time for strength and not for drunkenness. Right, okay, so because that's not going to help a king or a prince to get drunk.
Correct.
Verse 18, by slothfulness, the root of the house goeth to decay. By slothfulness, the roof of the house, okay, the roof of the house goeth to decay. And by the idleness of the hands, the house droppeth through. They prepare bread for laughter, and wine comforteth the living, but silver answereth to all. Silver probably means, right, money or wealth.
Money,
right. Verse 20, curse not the king, no, not in thy thought, neither curse the rich in thy bedchamber. For the soul of the, for the fowl of the heaven shall carry the voice, and that which hath wings shall declare the matter. So be careful who you're talking about, because you never know who's listening. Even the birds can go and eavesdrop on you. Figuratively speaking, I guess, right?
Omar, did you say that the birds will have droppings on you?
Yes.
Bird in the hand.
Eavesdroppings.
Don't look up.
All right. Man, what did the sinister say? Blessed is the land whose king is noble and whose princes eat in due season for refreshment and not for riotousness. I got that. That's good. That's good, sinister. Okay, chapter 11. Guys, I can't believe we're almost done with Ecclesiastes. Okay, hold on. One more chapter after this. Okay, chapter 11. And, oh, it's only 10 verses. Brian, do you want to read this one?
Sure.
Okay, hold on. Let me get to it. I'm going to open up my facsimile. Okay, I have a header, the intro. It says, to be liberal to the poor, not to doubt of God's providence. All worldly prosperity is but vanity. God will judge all. So those are a few of the bullet points in chapter 11. All right, Bride. So you're gonna read from the King James, and we'll follow along on the screen with the Geneva 1560.
All worldly prosperity is vanity. Okay, Ecclesiastes chapter 11 from King James Version. Yeah, this is very good. Cast thy bread upon the waters, for thou shalt find it after many days. Give a portion to seven and also to eight, for thou knowest not what evil shall be upon the earth. If the clouds be full of rain, they empty themselves upon the earth. And if the tree fall toward the south or toward the north, in the place where the tree falleth, there it shall be. He that observeth the wind shall not sow. So that's like, you know, keep your head out of the clouds. Get your head out of the clouds. He that observeth the wind shall not sow, and he that regardeth the clouds shall not reap. Get your head out of the clouds. As thou knowest not what is the way of the spirit, nor how the bones do grow in the womb of her that is with child, even so thou knowest not the works of God who maketh all. In the morning sow thy seed, and in the evening, withhold not thine hand, for thou knowest not whether shall prosper either this or that, or whether they both shall be alike good. Truly, the light is sweet, and a pleasant thing is for the eyes to behold the sun. But if a man live many years and rejoice in them all, yet let him remember the days of darkness, for they shall be many. All that cometh is vanity. Rejoice, O young man, in thy youth, and let thy heart cheer thee in the days of thy youth, and walk in the ways of thine heart, and in the sight of thine eyes. But know thou that for all these things God will bring thee into judgment. Therefore remove sorrow from thy heart, and put away evil from thy flesh. For childhood and youth are vanity.
The last line that Peter read, verse 10, can you read your verse 10? I'm just curious.
Remove vexation from your heart, and put away pain from your body. For youth and the dawn of life are vanity.
Wow. Man. Oh, guys, I don't know. Very, very, kind of just a really dismal outlook on life, I guess.
Somber,
yeah. If I was having a bad day, I probably wouldn't call Solomon. I wouldn't call Solomon. I'm like, dude.
Hey, you want to go out for a drive?
No, thank you.
No way.
Dude. Wow. Talk about emo, right?
Does he die after the song of Solomon, after that chapter?
Peter, what do you think?
You know what? I was just wondering, maybe is that where the word Solemn came from? Solomon?
Ooh. I don't know, Pete. That's a very interesting question there.
I mean, he's not definitely not an optimist, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, Solemn. I mean, Solemn. Wow. Let's see how he finishes this chapter. I think he's going to bring it home, guys. I think he's going to bring it home, and we may have a good ending here. Let's find out.
Wow, this one shows one goes all the way to number 8 or 7.
Okay,
it's all like so, one continuous.
Let me go ahead and turn there. It says to think on God in youth, and not to defer till age, the soul returneth to God. Wisdom is the gift of God, and consisteth in fearing him and keeping his commandments. So those are just bullet points on chapter 12. All right. So I'll go ahead and read. I'll read chapter 12. Let me get to it real quick. All right. So it's on verse 1. This is the last chapter of Ecclesiastes, and we're done. Verse 1, remember now thy Creator in the days of thy youth, whilst the evil days come not, nor the years approach wherein thou shalt say, I have no pleasure in them. Whilst the sun is not dark, nor the light, nor the moon, nor the stars, nor the clouds return after the rain, when the keepers of the house shall tremble, and the strong men shall bow themselves, and the grinders shall cease, because they are few, and they wax dark that look out by the windows. Verse 4. And the doors shall be shut without by the bass sound of the grinding, and he shall rise up at the voice of the bird, and all the daughters of singing shall be abased. Also they shall be afraid of the high thing, and fear shall be in the way, and the almond tree shall flourish, and the grasshopper shall be a burden, and concupiscence shall be driven away for man goeth to the house of his age, and the mourners go about in the street. What is that? So, and the door shall be shut without by the bass sound of the grinding, and he shall rise up with the voice of the bird, and all the tops of singing shall be abased. Verse 5, and they shall be afraid of the high thing, and fear shall be in the way, and the almond tree shall flourish, and the grasshopper shall be a burden, and concupiscence shall be, that's lust, shall be driven away, for man goeth to the house of his age. What does that mean? And the mourners go about in the street. What is he saying there? When he gets older, he won't desire women? Is that what chapter 5 is saying? I mean, verse 5 is saying, guys? What do you got in the ESV Shmores, verse 5?
They are afraid also of what is high, and terrors are in the way. The almond tree blossoms, the grasshopper drags itself along, and desire fails, because man is going to his eternal home, and the mourners go about the streets.
It's pretty much the same.
It keeps going. It's, it goes into 6.
Okay. Let's keep reading. Hold on.
6 and 7.
Verse 6 says, while the silver cord is not lengthened, nor the golden
bowl.
Yeah, it says the golden ewer, E-W-E-R. I think that's a bowl. Golden ewer broken, nor the pitcher broken at the well, nor the wheel broken at the cistern. Verse 6. And dust return to the earth as it was, and the spirit returned to God that gave it. Vanity of vanities, saith the preacher, all is vanity. So he's finishing the book here. He's saying it's all vanity. Verse 9. And the more wise the preacher was, the more he taught the people knowledge and caused them to hear and search forth and prepared many parables. The preacher sought to find out pleasant words and an upright writing, even the words of truth. Verse 11. The words of the wise are like goads and like nails fastened by the... What is that? Fastened by the masters of the assemblies, which are given by one pastor. What? The words of the wise are like goads. So that's like a stick that you poke the side of the animal, goading. The words of the wise are like goads, and the nails fastened by the masters of the assemblies, which are given by one pastor. and of other things besides these, my son, take thou heed, for there is none end in making many. There's none end in making many books, and much reading is a weariness of the flesh. He's right. He's saying, yeah, the more you fill yourself with knowledge, the more you realize how little you know. He says, you must read in this awareness of the flesh, verse 13. Let us hear the end of all. He said, this is what it's all about. Let me put a ribbon on this. Okay, guys? He says, thank you for listening to me for these past 12 chapters. Let me go ahead and just put a ribbon on it. Fear God and keep his commandments. For this is the whole duty of man. Verse 14 says, for God will bring every work unto judgment with every secret thing, whether it be good or evil. Wow. Wow. What do you guys think, man? We're done. Wow. You know, it's like you watched a really good movie and the acting was phenomenal. And, you know, the story, everything, but you walk out of the movie and you're like, what just happened?
What?
Right. I don't know, Bri.
Writing the stuff and he's, you know, he's going through the stuff and he realizes he's at the end. He's like, what the heck, you know? Just follow the commandments. Keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man.
Yeah.
Whew. It's like he says that he could have gone from chapter one and just put that verse in there.
Yeah.
Fear God and keep his commandments. That's it.
Well, tomorrow it'll be the last of Solomon's, the poetic works, because basically Song of Solomon. That'll be the extent of what we have for the poetical books. And then we're going to get into Isaiah. So actually tomorrow we will finish Song of Solomon, all 8 verses.
Really?
Oh, yeah. All 8 verses tomorrow, guys. Another book. Yep. And that was a really interesting love story. Hard to follow, though. You guys will, tomorrow when we're reading it, I'll probably get 2 highlighters. And before we read tomorrow, I'm going to try to highlight when the girl is speaking.
You know, I was just going to ask you.
Yeah.
In the ESV, the first verse is like the Song of Songs, which is Solomon. The second song, it says she is bold, at capital S-H-E, bold. And then number 5 is she in bold. Number 8 is he. And then
it gets confusing.
Other. Yeah, it's got he, she, others, and he, she, and others in bold.
They have this whole little play between the two of them. And you just have to be very careful and when you're reading it, because sometimes you'll read something and you think it's the guy talking and it's actually the girl. So
they don't do that in the King James.
Yeah, I'll try tomorrow before we read tomorrow.
I can give it to you in the beginning. I mean, it's pretty. I was wondering why it says he on some of them.
Yeah,
not every verse. Just, you know, some say he, she, others she, and then he and she. That's it. It's not every verse though.
Well, for all you single guys out there. Tomorrow, please promise us that you're not going to use any of these pickup lines because they don't sound good anymore.
Okay, I'll talk to Peter.
Telling a girl that her nose is like a Tower of Babylon or something. It's not, that's not cool. It's not cool, guys. Do not do that.
Open up my soda with that nose.
Yeah. Hey, Bride, can you don't laugh. Close us in prayer, Bride, and let me see who else.
How about this one? Oh, your hair is like a flock of goats.
Yeah, dude, that's you guys are gonna laugh tomorrow.
That's gonna get points.
That's how you get points.
You're going to laugh tomorrow.
Oh, my Lord.
Thank you, guys. Pray for my wife, Bride. She's at work. I always pray for her because she's well fed. Thank God. She did have a little mishap at work last week, and it wasn't anything major. She wasn't exposed to anything dangerous. But just working in a hospital, there's always stuff that she's exposed to, and I always just pray for her. So you can pray for my wife. I appreciate that. Anyhow. And then, of course, continue to pray for Samantha and Bellinger and Judy's living situation. We're just trusting the Lord on that. And the normal stuff. All right, hold on, Brian. Take it away, brother. Thank you. It's good to have you back, Peter.
Thank you. Yeah, good to be back. Thank you, Omar. Okay, we're going to start with a beautiful prayer from Mr. Rain. Thank you so much, Rain. We love your prayers. Receive, O Lord. Receive, O Lord, our prayers at this hour and guide our life toward thy commandments. That's beautiful right there. When we were lost and we didn't know the Lord, our life was not guided toward his commandments. That's beautiful. Receive, O Lord, our prayers at this hour and guide our life toward thy commandments. Sanctify our souls. Make chaste our bodies. Correct our thoughts. Purify our intentions and deliver us from every sorrow, evil, and pain. We praise thee, holy name, unto the ages of ages, forever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. That's awesome, beautiful. Thank you, Rain. Heavenly Father, we love you, Lord. Thank you for bringing us together in this wonderful time of fellowship to be strengthened by your word and to have our faith increase, be strengthened. Lord, I thank you for Rain. I thank you for Jeno. I pray for them. Thank you for Brandon, for Samantha. Pray that you continue to guide their hearts towards your commandments. I thank you for Rob. I thank you for Judy. I thank you for Teresa. I thank you for Gracie. I thank you for Flat Stuff Earth. Flat Stuff Earth. Thank you for all of our gifts and our talents that we have in being able to connect with people and getting messages out there in our own unique way, touching the hearts of others and sharing the good news of salvation to those that need to hear about you, Lord. I pray for those that will be able to find the recording, to listen along, that you draw them close. You draw them close to you and also guide their hearts towards your commandments. I thank you for Dots. I thank you for Mia. I thank you for Anita. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, guys. All right, man. Hey, have a beautiful night, guys. Schmores, welcome back. Oh, hold on. You guys are crisscross.
Didn't go anywhere.
Hold on. You're crisscross. There you go. There. That's how you're supposed to be.
See, the wind is coming out of the north. I keep telling you that.
There you go, guys. The brothers are back. It's good to have you back, guys. And right. Ronnie, where's Ronnie? We missed him. He hasn't been on for a few.
What happened to Ronnie?
Is he okay?
You still running?
Yeah, I spoke to him earlier. I'll call him tomorrow when we're on the.
You and him got in a fight because he picked up on your girl.
Look at his right hand. Keep an eye on that right hand.
That's what happened, man. Don't trust him, bro.
Yeah.
But anyhow, guys.
When you use too much grease.
Yeah. All right.
Which was that? Butch wax?
All right. You guys are awesome, man. All right, man. Have a beautiful night, everybody. God bless you. And we'll be back tomorrow in the Book of Love, Song of Songs, Song of Solomon.
I think Gilligan's coming back, right?
He's going to be back soon, very soon.
Because he's musical, you know?
Yes, yes. All right, Brian. Awesome, guys. BD, tomorrow, business day, brother. We're back. Yeah. We're back in the saddle tomorrow.
Let's do it with all our might, Omar.
Amen. Amen, guys.
Let's do it with all our might. Let's handle it.
God bless you. Hey, Judy, Peter and I, we are going to take a little drive up there to go look at a property. So pray for us up over near your house. So we're really excited about that. All right, guys. Thank you so much. Have a great night, everyone.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Hasta mañana.
You got it.
Night, guys. All right. Yeah.